Good morning. Welcome to worship on this beautiful June morning. Lots of plans today. I've been hearing about lots of people going outside. I'm going to go to the pool later today, even though it might be a little cold. We have a few announcements before we begin worship. We have Caden Brown with us today playing guitar, so welcome to you, and we're glad to have you here. He's going to be playing guitar for our hymns. And then we also have Father's Day coming up next week, and Mia will be providing brownies, right? Okay, that sounds, brownies and ice cream. You can't miss that. That sounds delicious. And then the following Sunday, we have our Hymn Sing Sunday. We just got a couple of hymns in today, but we'll also do something that was suggested by one of our congregants, that we'll have a time for everybody to look through their hymnal, and we're going to test Kathy. We'll call out a hymn number, and she'll play for us, and then we'll sing the first verse of it, and we'll just keep going around. Doesn't that sound fun? Jessica's making a... Yeah, it does sound. And then I was going to talk with Kathy, too, to see if we could have a few stump you guys on a few hymns. Maybe we play something, and then you tell us what it is. So it'll be a fun hymn sing Sunday, and that's on the 23rd. And then also, we have a new member of our flock. We have a little mama killdeer that has nested over by my office, and she keeps shooing me away from the door and my car, and she's got attitude. So if you guys could watch for her, she's all over the parking lot. She's shaking her feathers at all the trucks and everything. She is nested right on the corner in the rocks. So we'll kind of keep an eye on that. Let's see what happens over these next few weeks, and we'll see what we can do about taking care of Mama Killdeer a little bit. So, are there any other joys, concerns, or announcements? Seeing no others, I invite you to stand in body or spirit, and we'll turn to our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, and the God of mercy. Amen. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God, siblings in Christ, in Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of all miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. Amen. Our gathering hymn is number 768. Lead me, guide me. Kathy's going to sing along with us. Caden, you're playing too? All right, and the words are up on the screen. Otherwise, we can turn in our hymnals.
Oh,
What a beautiful hymn, huh? The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. And again, your prayer of the day is on the readings insert. All-powerful God, in Jesus Christ you turned death into life and defeat into victory. Increase our faith and trust in him, that we may triumph over all evil in the strength of the same Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The congregation may be seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Our first reading is from Genesis chapter 3. Adam and Eve heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" He said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself." He said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the fruit, the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me fruit from the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is it that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent tricked me, and I ate." The Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you among all animals and among all wild creatures. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity into you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. You will strike your head, and you will strike his heel." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read Psalm 130 responsively. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. If you were to keep watch over sins, O Lord, who could stand?
Yet with you is forgiveness, in order that you may be feared.
I wait for you, O Lord, my soul waits. In your word is my hope.
My soul waits for the Lord more than those who keep watch for the morning, more than those who keep watch for the morning.
O Israel, wait for the Lord. Wait with the Lord, there is steadfast love. With the Lord, there is plenteous redemption.
The Lord shall redeem Israel from all sins.
Our second reading is from 2 Corinthians. Just as we have the same spirit of faith that is in accordance with Scripture, "I believed, and so I spoke," we also believe, and so we speak, because we know that one who raised Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and will bring us with you into his presence. Yes, everything is for your sake, so that grace, as it extends to more and more people, may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. So we do not lose heart, even though our outer nature is wasting away, our inner nature is being renewed day by day. For this slight momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all measure, because we look not at what we can see, but at what cannot be seen. For what can be seen is temporary, but what cannot be seen is eternal. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in heaven. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
I invite the congregation to please stand as you are able to welcome the gospel.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel according to Mark, the third chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus went home, and the crowd came together again so that Jesus and the disciples could not even eat. When his family heard it, they went out to restrain him, for people were saying he has gone out of his mind. And the scribes who came down from Jerusalem said, he has Beelzebul, and by the ruler of the demons, he casts out demons. And he called them to him and spoke to them in parables. How can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand, but his end has come. But no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his property without first tying up the strong man. Then indeed the house can be plundered. Truly, I tell you, people will be forgiven for their sins and whatever blasphemies they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit can never have forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. For they had said, he has an unclean spirit. Then his mother and his brothers came, and standing outside, they sent to him and called him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, your mother and your brothers and sisters are outside asking for you. And he replied, who are my mother and my brothers? And looking at those who sat around him, he said, here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of God is my brother and sister and mother. The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. The congregation may be seated. Oh boy. There is a lot of drama, conflict, and tension in today's gospel text. The only way that we could have more drama in this text is if it included the Kardashians. Really, that's how much drama and conflict and tension. There's a lot going on here. One of the biggest tensions is at the beginning, right? The word on the street is that Jesus has lost his marbles, right? Yeah, that he's off his rocker. He has gone out of his mind. Now, his family, and I can understand this, are concerned about him. So they've decided to go out and restrain him. I shared with the group on Wednesday night that when I was 19 and I was at UW-Madison, my parents came to, quote unquote, restrain me once and take me home. And it wasn't pleasant, you guys. But it was for the same reason, right? To protect me. And I think Jesus' family loves him and cares for him. And they want to protect him from all that is going on. One of the other things that's happening in this text is the size of the crowd. If you can imagine with me here, the crowd has amassed so much so that Jesus and his disciples can't even eat. Now, were any of you raised in big families around a table and you were going for elbow room, right? Or if you're a right-handed person and two of my siblings are left-handers, and then you sit next to them and you're always looking for elbow room. Jesus and his disciples are so surrounded by the crowd that they can't even get elbow room to eat. That's a big crowd, you guys. And that would make me nervous as a parent, a brother or sister too, because as we all know, crowds can kind of change in mood in a heartbeat. But that size of the crowd is also a tension and a conflict for the scribes or the religious leaders, too. They don't like that big crowd following Jesus, do they? They don't want that big crowd following him because they're hearing his preaching and his teaching, and even more so, they're witnessing all of the mighty acts of power that he is doing, including just a little bit before this text, he went ahead and cast out a demon out of a person in the synagogue. So the scribes are looking for anything to discredit Jesus, right? He's stirring the pot. He's preaching all these countercultural kinds of things, and they want to discredit him. They want to somehow disperse the crowd that follows him. So in this text today, they go with the argument, it takes one to know one. Have you ever heard that phrase before? It takes one to know one. So sometimes they say it takes a liar to know a liar. Sometimes they say it takes a thief to catch a thief, right? There's another one, it takes a bad cook to know another bad cook, so I must be a great cook. Not really, terrible. Tim's not here to counter that today. But it takes one to know one, which means that they're making the argument that Jesus must be a demon himself in order to see them in other people, in order to cast them out. It takes one to know one, which is one of the greatest blasphemies ever. Our text talks a little bit about blasphemes against the Holy Spirit. This would be an example of it because, in essence, they are saying that the power that Jesus draws upon for his teaching and preaching and miracles, like feeding the 5,000 and walking on water and casting out demons, isn't from God, but it's from Satan himself. Can you imagine that? That just sounds just absolutely shocking, doesn't it? It's absolutely shocking, and it is an example of one of the blasphemies that Jesus is talking about here. Now, Jesus always gives us an example of what to do when people are coming at you. We had that last week too, right? They're coming at him about all the Sabbath laws. In this case, they're coming at him with a huge defamation campaign. They're not saying, oh, this is not the Son of God, this is the son of Satan over here. I mean, this is a big campaign against Jesus. And instead of getting into all the legality, instead of getting up to kind of start casting dispersions on other people or even defending his innocence, instead, again, he teaches. That's a lesson for all of us here. And he uses a parable to teach them. Now, this parable is a little different, if you will, because the parable is about a house that's full of goods and a strong man that's kind of standing at the door like this, right? And Jesus is telling us, in order to get past that strong man at the door, you're going to have to send in someone stronger. You don't want to send in somebody to rob that house that's like kind of a little wimpy dude, right? Because that strong man's just going to flick him away and say, shoo, fly, shoo, right? So you got to send in somebody who's stronger. Now, one of the things about this parable is that the strong man at the door represents Satan. And the person who is being sent in to go ahead and plunder Satan's house is Jesus. And Jesus is telling all of them there and all of us now that his power exceeds anything Satan has to offer. Jesus goes in, subdues and ties up, if you will, Satan, and plunders Satan's house by casting out those demons. And I always think about, in this text, in this parable, I always kind of imagine Jesus tossing out Satan's laundry and possessions out on the front lawn too, right? Plundering the house, because Jesus' power is so much greater than anything at all Satan has to offer. And then the idea about the divided house is interesting too, because Jesus is touching on good versus evil in this parable. He's telling us that Satan's house is certainly divided. It is divided by hate and violence and spite and greed, and we could keep going on and on. All of those things divide Satan's house. Satan's house is built on sand. It will fall apart. But God's house, and we heard before from Brenda in our second reading, God's house is eternal. God's house is good. God's house is built on and in love and mercy and grace and forgiveness for all. That house is the house that stands eternally and forever. That is a gift to us, siblings in Christ, that gift of God's indivisible house that is filled with love and grace and mercy. It doesn't change at all, because the world will attempt to divide us, right? There's so many things that happen in our lives that either try to divide who we are or who our families are or who our houses or communities or schools are. So many things come at us in an attempt to divide us. But this gift that we have of knowing that God's house is indivisible, God's house is mighty and strong, and we stand there by God's gift of grace. We are with God in that house, so that no matter what is thrown at us, that we know that God is a strong, almighty God who will hold on to us in steadfast love, mercy, and grace, not just today, not just tomorrow, but forever, eternally. Amen. We will be singing a wonderful kind of declaration hymn of God's conquering over evil, God of Grace and Glory, number 705. And the words will be on the screen. Otherwise, too, we can turn in our hymnals. And I invite the congregation, please stand in body or spirit. With the whole church, let us use the words of the Apostles' Creed to confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We come before the triune God to pray for our communities, ourselves, and our world. You reawaken our hearts to your mercy. We give you thanks for renewers of the church in every age. Enliven the creativity and persistence of all seeking to transform the church into a closer vision of your beloved community. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Your presence is revealed in the shade of trees, the growth of seeds into flowers, and in the blessing of plants granting food in their right season. Heal lands scarred by deforestation, pollution, or infestation. Teach us to cultivate the earth with respect and reverence. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Our nations and communities are divided, O God. Teach us again to listen with curiosity and mercy, even in disagreement. Grant us the humility to acknowledge our hardness of heart and make us bold in modeling cooperation for the sake of the common good. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Hear the prayers of all who cry out to you from the depths of fear, despair, or hopelessness. With haste, rescue victims of trafficking, exploitation, and abuse, and bless organizations and individuals who work on their behalf. Heal those in need of healing, especially Chris, Joan, Jared, Angelica, Beverly, Glenn, Kurt, Kelly, Robert, Dorothy, Alvina, Lois, Tammy, and all those we name aloud now or silently in our hearts. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Grant wisdom and clarity to all who are in seasons of discernment and transition. High school graduates preparing for first jobs or new educational journeys, those who are shifting careers, and those who are navigating changes in their relationships. Accompany them with your peace. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Praise to you for our ancestors in faith who believed, spoke, and lived in you. Give us confidence that as Jesus was raised, so we too will be raised with all the saints into your everlasting presence, merciful God.
Receive our prayer. Receive our prayers, O God, and come quickly to our aid through the power of the Spirit and the love of Jesus Christ. Amen. May the peace of Christ be with you always. I invite you to share a sign of peace with one another. Peace be with you. I invite you to please stand in body or spirit, and we'll turn to our offertory hymn, number 674. Jesus, bread of life, you have set this table with your very self and called us to the feast of plenty. Gather what has been sown among us and strengthen us in this meal. Make us to be what we receive here, your body for the life of the world. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." With this bread and with this cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life as we proclaim the mystery of faith together. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ has set the table with more than enough. Come, all are welcome. And the congregation is invited to be seated, and it'll just take us a few moments.
Thank you.
I invite you to please stand as you are able. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. And may the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. Amen. We're going out on a good one today, an oldie but a goodie, Rock of Ages. And Caden, are you playing with this one too? Okay, this will be great. Christ. Thanks be to God. Have a good week, everybody.